Hi friends, today we will discuss the answer for question number 20, which falls under history, as you can see. So, it is regarding the architecture during the Chola era. Generally in history, as you can see in the last few years, UPS is asking analytical questions, analytical. However, though you are trying to analyze the question given, though your answer is logical, analytical, still you try to use facts, as many facts as you can, just as examples or whatever. And also, if the question is regarding architecture, try to draw diagrams. Diagrams can be bad. You know to draw really good diagrams, some rough diagrams, so that the evaluator actually gets a feel that you know the structure of the architecture, the structure of the temple, the shape of the temple, whatever. And also he'll feel that you have got some, you know, you have got some love for the architecture when you draw the diagrams. So don't keep the answer very dry. Make it interesting for evaluator, because history answers generally are slightly boring. So try to create some interest. Okay, let us come to this question. The statement says, the most sophisticated buildings in the form of temples were built during Chola era. And then they give the question, discuss the special features of Chola architecture, is one question. Another one is, compare it with other imperial architectures. The other imperial architecture, South India. South Indian imperial architectures broadly fall under Pallavas, the Cholas, the Nayakas, before the Nayakas, the Vijayanagaras. Vijayanagara. So you compare Chola with the remaining three. That's what you have to do. So in the introduction, what we will do is, we will tell why it is most sophisticated, why Chola era is the most sophisticated. So in the introduction, you can briefly write the history. You can start from the background, from the Pallavas. You can say that the Dravidian style of architecture, the Dravidian style of architecture of temples started during Pallavas. But by the time of Cholas, they have grown in their style, and they have reached the culmination during Cholas. Particularly after 850 AD. From 850 AD, the growth in the style of Chola architecture has been tremendous, and it reached the zenith and culmination during Rajendra Chola, after Rajaraja Chola, like that. Also, you can say the earlier Cholas used to build temples with bricks, and they are small structures. Whereas the later Cholas have, the imperial Cholas have built the colossal buildings, large buildings with large mandapas, large gopurams, you know, fresco paintings and great big statues, etc. So they reached the most sophisticated forms by 1090-1080 AD. So this can be the introduction. The introduction is just to explain the statement given in the question. Now you have to discuss the special features of Chola architecture. Special features. So, generally, as you discuss the features, along with the features, you better give some examples. Why are you giving examples? The reason is, you are trying to tell the evaluator that you know some of the temples of Chola architecture. Means you should somehow throw the facts in the answer. The only way you can show your factual knowledge in the answer is by giving examples. So, don't just write the features and leave it. Mention some examples so that evaluator knows that you know the temples. Okay, for example, one special feature you see is the fresco paintings. The fresco paintings found along the walls of Chola temples, example, the Airavateshwar temple, you can find them. Similarly, the Dwarapalas, they are the gods at the entrance of the mandapas. Two gods would be there generally as Dwarapalas, and these Dwarapalas is a special feature of Chola architecture. You can find it in almost every temple. And you can write example of Gangaikonda Cholapuram temple. Then the niches. Niches are kind of SS, they are depressions. If this is a wall, within the wall there would be some depression like this. A depression will be built within the wall. In that depression, they would carefully place the statue, or they will put the image of the god or goddess. And around that, they would make more niches. Around the main niche, they would make small niches where they would be secondary gods around the main god. We call this concept as Devakustas concept, which is unique to the Chola architecture. Then massiveness. The Chola temples are massive. For example, Brigadeshwar, also called as the big temple, built in 1010 AD. by Rajaraja Chola. By Rajaraja Chola, it has been built completely with the granite. Completely granite. It is the first temple built completely with granite. And it was a marvel because such a large amount of rock moved just in 6 years. Just in 6 years, they were able to build that building. That's why it falls under the UNESCO. UNESCO Heritage Sites, it falls under Brihadeeshwara. Then another special feature is the Ganas. Ganas are actually devotees of Lord Shiva. They are mostly lost in devotion. You can find these Ganas at many places throughout the temple. Example, Brahma Puriswara temple. See, Ganas are found in other temples also. But as you have already named other temples, you name a new temple. For example, if you do not know Brahma Puriswara temple, you again name the Ganga Konchalapuram or Airavateshwara, again name the same temple because every temple Ganas are there. In some temples, more Ganas will be there. Then you know the Parivar Devtas. Parivar Devtas means subsidiary gods. For example, if this is a temple with the main god, there will be small temples around that with subsidiary gods. Many temples will be there around the main temple. This is a special feature of Chola architecture. Now, second part of the question says, you compare the Chola architecture with other South Indian architectural temple architecture. So, let us start comparing with Vijayanagara first. So, in Vijayanagara temples, you find supernatural horses in the temple, whereas in Cholas, such horses are not there. Only kudus will be there. For example, you know, if this is a pillar, at the end of the pillar, there would be horseshoe shaped like this. Would be there, kudus in the Cholas, whereas in Vijayanagara, supernatural horses would be there. Similarly, in Vijayanagara temples, Kalyan Mandapa's concept is there. Kalyan Mandapa would be there, which you cannot see in the Chola temples. Similarly, the raised mandapas, the open mandapas, which are raised. See, if this is a mandapa, raised with steps, raised mandapas, pillars, raised mandapas can be seen in the Vijayanagara architecture in the temples, but not in Chola temples. Even secular buildings, for example, in Vijayanagara temples, you can find the design consisting not only of the Dravidian style but also Islamic style. You can find the Islamic style. That's why we call secular buildings. For example, if you see the horse stables, you can see it will be like this. Indian style, then the Islamic style, then the Indian style, then the Islamic dome style. So you can just draw like this. You don't draw excellent diagrams. You can just draw this kind of secular buildings. Not only the elephant stables, even Lotus Mahal, the watchtowers of the Vijayanagara temples are secular buildings. And this concept is not found in the Chola temples. Then now let us compare Chola temples with the Pallava temples. How the architecture is different. In Pallavas, you can find alley. Alley means it is a line motif. If this is a pillar, below the pillar you can find a line. You see a line. Line motif can found below the pillar. Whereas in Cholas, as I told you already, kudus. Kudus means, you know, the horseshoe shape will be there behind the pillar of Chola temples. Then even the Dwarapalas. In the Pallava temples, Dwarapalas are very kind. They are very gentle. Whereas in Chola temples, the Dwarapalas are aggressive, they are ferocious, with protruding tusks, they are ferocious. Even the Gopurams also, Pallavas, the Gopurams are dwarf, they are short Gopuram. See, this is a Gopuram, for example, this is a Gopuram. Like this, a Gopuram. A Gopuram is small in the Pallavas, but its colossal are large in the Cholas. However, if you compare with the Nayakas, you find a different thing. In Nayakas, the Gopurams of Nayakas are actually more sophisticated, more colossal, bigger. Because Nayakas came after Cholas, and Nayakas are famous for these Gopurams. They have built the Gopurams for existing temples also. And we can say it's the Zenith. It's a culmination of the Gopurams in the Nayaka style. Even if you compare the Nayaka with Cholas, the Prakram. What it is in Nayaka temples, if this is a temple, around the temple you find large corridors, they are roofed corridors, these corridors have a roof, they are roofed corridors, large corridors connecting throughout the temple. Such kind of corridors you do not find in Cholas. So these are the various differences you can mention. Then see, you may be thinking that this kind of diagrams does not look good, but actually it is enough. You don't need to draw beautiful diagrams, just some diagram, rough diagram, just to show how the structure or shape of the temples are. And believe me, definitely get more marks in the history answers when you could can draw diagrams. And students who do not know the facts, use some fact. Some fact you have to use, some fact or some date. History essentially means some fact should be thrown in. Even if they do not ask, UPSC never asks you directly on the factual questions. The questions are analytical, but you have to somehow insert the facts. That's the technique to score more in the ancient and medieval history of India. In modern history, you cannot use those diagrams. Now the question for tomorrow, the question is regarding Kesavananda Bharati case, as it is in the news. As many students can write the question very easily in this kind of easy questions, as everyone writes the answer, only that student who writes an answer with good facts, good logic and good statements, good articles of the Constitution of India, he will get more marks. So try to write the answer in that format. See you, friends. Bye.